Hear you. Yeah. I'm so excited to be here with you all this morning. So excited to see a bunch of you yesterday at the Touch of Dutch Festival. This community is such a wonderful place to be a part of, and this body is such a wonderful place to be a part of. And so it's just a blessing for me and my family. And I think it's a blessing for each and every one of you, even if you don't want to admit it. Looking at you, Jeff. I want to remind you guys this morning before we get into worship that we do in the next month, most of our small groups will be resuming their normal meeting schedules, which is a great thing because our small groups are one of the most amazing parts of this church. I enjoy every meeting with mine, and I hope that they do as well, even though they have to put up with me. I know that we've heard some amazing stories coming out of small groups. So do me a favor, okay? If you are a part of a small group already, tell somebody how much enjoyment you find in it. And if you're not a part of a small group already, in the Connection Center after service, there is placards up on the wall that have small group names, small group meeting times, and contact information. Go and call somebody. See what you can do to get to be a part of one and enjoy that discipleship, because I'm often reminded of the quote from the late Tim Keller, who says that there is no deeper involvement in discipleship than joining together with those of you who share a body. And so look around you. These are your people. We join together because we love each other. We show Christ to each other through our love, through our understanding, through our pursuit of Him in unity with each other. So as we prepare for worship this morning, think about this. This body, how can we, as a church, how can we love Christ greater? How can we show our love for Christ greater? And how can we be a better embodiment and a better light to Him? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank You. We thank You for the opportunity to be here to worship You, Lord. You are so worthy, so utterly worthy of everything that we can give You, Lord. So I just pray that You give us a wonderful opportunity to sing songs about You, to lift our hands to You, to open our hearts to You, Lord. I pray that we see You this morning, both in worship and word, Lord, that we can embrace Your grace, Your mercy this morning. Lord, I just pray that we see You so clearly. Lord, I pray that this body be known as a body that worships the one true God, the one who is amazing and awesome and without fault and completely perfect, Lord. We look to You for guidance. We look to You for love, Lord, and we look to You because there is nothing else worth looking at, Lord. In Your name we pray. Amen.
I'll go where You stay, I'll stay. When You move, I'll move. I will follow.
Follow where You go, I'll go.
shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house.
Matthew 7:24-27 says, Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat that house, but it did not fall, because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it.
Yeah. the name above every other name.
Everybody say it.
Jesus, the only one.
is so true. We build our lives upon your love. Like the song says, Lord God, we are leaning on the everlasting arms of God as you hold us so close, Father. Father, I pray that if there's anyone in this room who has not experienced the relationship, the embrace, the grace, the love of you, Lord, I just pray that your Spirit descend upon that person and fill them with a conviction that they can never turn away from, Lord. Because, Father, we know who you are. You are our Redeemer. You are our Savior. You are our Father. Father, we lift up this service to you, and I pray that everything that is sung, said, acted out, be with love and glorify you and you alone. So we say all these things in the precious name of your Son, Jesus Christ. And all of God's people said, amen.
You can have a seat. We're going to continue to worship through the giving of our tithes and offerings. If you're a guest with us this morning, we're so glad you're here. Please know there's no expectation at all for you to give, but we do want to take this time just to give back to God off everything that he has blessed us with. But also, if you are a guest, there are some little cards there in the rectory. If you would be so kind as to fill one of those out so we know who you are, how we can connect with you, how we can be praying for you or encouraging you. We'd love to be able to do that. But I wanted just to invite you just to join me in prayer as we prepare to give this morning. God, we just thank you, God, for all the ways, God, that you bless us, for all the ways, God, that you provide for us, for all the ways, Lord, that you remind us of your faithfulness and your goodness to us, Lord. And God, as we give these tithes, these offerings, God, back to you, God, we pray that you would take them, you would bless them, that you would use them, Lord, God, to share your love with this community, God, with this region, with this nation, with this world, God, that your Spirit would work in and through them, Lord, for your honor and glory. And I pray this all in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. And as we receive our offerings for any kids, you can go ahead, you can head back for Bible Adventures this morning, and we're going to continue to worship through song as well. You can remain seated as we do that, as we sing our next song. We'll receive our offering at this time.
Whatever my lot, thou hast told.
God, we just thank you, Lord, God, just for the peace, God, that only you can give, God, for the way that it just gives us, the way it gives us hope, the way that it gives us comfort, the way that it gives us strength, Lord. And God, we pray, God, that as we hear your word today, God, that your word would teach us, that your word would encourage us, that your word would instruct us, Lord, and that you would just get all the honor and glory for all of it, God. And I pray this in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. So we're in the second week of a series of messages on the book of Daniel this morning. We're going to be in Daniel chapter 3. And as always, there is an outline you can follow along with in your bulletin this morning that you can kind of fill in to kind of help you follow along with what we're going to talk about, but also that you can kind of take home as a reminder of what we talked about. They can encourage you. They can remind you throughout your week of some things that we've heard and talked about this morning. But I want to kind of just remind you of kind of where we were last week in Daniel chapters 1 and 2. So the book of Daniel is written when they are in captivity in Babylon. So they have been captured, they've been taken away from their home, they've been taken away from everything that they know, and they are now in exile in Babylon. If you remember last week, we talked about the goal of exile was to functionally eliminate the culture of the conquered nation. They would try to assimilate them or have them become like they were. So in this case, they were expected to become like the Babylonians. We're supposed to believe like you, act like you, do the things that you do, act the way that you act, basically the way that you used to live, the way that you used to be. Food that Babylon has to offer, or do we stick to what God has told us he wants us to do and eat only vegetables? Eat the things that God has said are clean or are proper for us to eat. And when they did that, God showed up and was faithful to them and was true to them and was there for them. So now in Daniel 3, we're going to kind of get the next example of this kind of a thing where, again, there's going to be a choice that's going to have to be made. And I want to kind of just frame it for you this way. We make choices every single day. Choices we don't even think about that we make. From when you wake up in the morning, what food you're going to eat, what clothes you're going to wear, what things you're going to listen to, what things you're going to watch, who you're going to talk to, where you're going to go. We make all kinds of decisions every day. Many of those we don't really spend much time thinking about. We just make them. But then there's other kinds of decisions that are bigger, that are more significant, that have a bigger impact. And we're going to be talking about a decision like that this morning. A decision that gets your heart rate going. A decision that kind of maybe sparks some anxiety or some worry or some fear. A decision where we worry about what the outcome, what the result, what the impact might be. We also make decisions like that. So in Daniel 3, King Nebuchadnezzar builds a statue. It was a big gold statue, and the command was given that when the instruments play, there's a whole list of instruments. You can follow along in Daniel 3 if you want to open your Bible to that. We're going to be kind of looking through some different things from Daniel 3 this morning. But when the instruments play, the expectation was you will bow down and you will worship this statue. You will stop whatever you're doing. When the music plays, you'll bow down and you'll worship the statue that has been built. And the penalty for not doing so was to be thrown into a fiery furnace. Or depending on what translation you read, a blazing hot furnace. The principle is the same, a furnace that is really, really, really hot. We're going to talk a little bit more about that in a minute. So it was really a life or death decision. Either you do what you're commanded to do, bow down to this statue, and worship it, or get thrown into a furnace and die. That was the choice that was in front of not only Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, but all the Babylonian people. They had to choose, are we going to listen to and do what the king is asking us to do, or are we going to choose something different at risk of our lives? So Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, they have a choice to make. And this is one of those choices that we talked about. They know that this is a choice that is going to have consequences. They know that this is a choice that is going to have a big impact on their life. It's something they need to take very seriously. So if you read through here, we get to verse 8, and we read this. At this time, some astrologers came forward and announced to the Jews, that's Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They said to King Nebuchadnezzar, may the king live forever. Your majesty has issued a decree that everyone who hears the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, pipe, and all kinds of music must fall down and worship the image of gold, and that whoever does not fall down and worship will be thrown into a blazing furnace. But there are some Jews whom you have set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who pay no attention to you, your majesty. They neither serve your gods nor worship the image of gold you have set up. So we have some power-hungry people. We have some people who are looking for a step up the ladder. Say, hey, king, they're not listening. They're not loyal to you. They're not paying attention to you. Functionally, hey, king, what are you going to do about it? Those guys over there, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, the guys you put in charge over the province of Babylon, they're not doing what you asked them to do. Is that the kind of person you want in charge? Is that the person you want making decisions? Is that really the example that you want set for the people? And that really then sets up the climax of the story. The order has been given by Nebuchadnezzar. The information has been relayed to him by these astrologers. You might read it as Chaldeans in a different translation. But now everything is kind of coming to a head. And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego have to make their decision. And they knew it was going to be a life-changing decision. And you will have to make decisions that are big, life-changing decisions. So I want you just to think with me for a second. What kind of big, life-changing decisions have you made in your life? Depending how old you are, you might have a harder time thinking of one. But the older we are, the more we can think of, right? Big decisions that we know are going to impact our life. Decisions, maybe like what career path we might want to go into, what school might want to attend, who we may want to marry, what we choose to believe. All of these kinds of decisions can be big decisions that we know are going to impact and shape and have influence on our life. And when you're faced with one of those decisions, it's good and it's proper for us just to pause, to think, to reflect, to consider all the possibilities, all the options, all the possible outcomes, to really think through what is really the best decision for me to make. What is the best thing that I can do for me and what I'm hoping to do with my life, with who I am, what my values are, and all of those things. And that's the moment that we find Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego facing. And it's decisions like this, it's decisions like that, that can be attached to a person's name for the rest of their life. I mean, think about it. Here in the book of Daniel, we don't know a whole lot about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Other than that, they were Jews. They were brought there as captives. They find their way to be an official within the Babylonian kingdom, making some decisions. But what we really know them for is a decision. This decision that they're going to make about what they're going to do in response to King Nebuchadnezzar's order to worship the statue. And we know of examples like this, right? If I were to tell you the name Benedict Arnold, what do you think of? Traitor, right? I mean, it becomes a term you use. Hey, you're a Benedict Arnold. Why? Because you were a traitor. You weren't loyal. You weren't faithful. That decision that Benedict Arnold made is now forever associated with his name. It becomes a term, like I said, that we use to describe other people who make a similar type of decision. What about Abraham Lincoln? We're thinking of the Emancipation Proclamation. We think about the role that he had in ending slavery in our nation. Rosa Parks, her decision to not give up her seat on that bus, right? her decision to remain seated. When you think the name Rosa Parks, you think of that moment, don't you? You think of that decision she made on that bus in Alabama and what she knew that would mean for her. It's this kind of decision that's now going to be attached to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They know that what they decide is going to stick with them, is going to go with them. It's something that's going to be remembered. And decisions like that, that carry weight, that carry significance, that we know are going to have impact, can feel like you're standing in a furnace. Right? Your pulse rate quickens a little bit. Maybe you start to sweat a little bit. You get nervous. You get anxious. Your mind maybe starts going a million different directions, thinking about all the possibilities and wondering maybe about, well, what would this person do? What would that person do? What might happen if I do this? We can feel the pressure. We can feel the heat. We can feel the weight of the decision. But I think there's something that's important to think about here. When we face those kinds of moments, when we face those pressure-filled moments, when we face those furnace-like moments, how do you view the furnace? I want you to think about this with me. How do you view the furnace? Because furnaces were used for two things. They were used to burn things up or incinerate them, or they were used to refine, to purify things, to take alloy metals and to purify them, to get pure copper or gold or silver, to burn off all the impurities, to burn off everything that was going to not be used in order to get that pure metal. A furnace could do either one of those things. It could be used to consume something, to burn it up, to dispose of it, or it could be used to refine something, to purify it, to make it pure, to make it more precious, to make it more valuable. So when you face those kinds of moments, how do you view them? Do you look at them through the lens of, this is something that could burn me up. This is something that could consume me. This is something that could really just take out all of me. Or do you see this as an opportunity for refinement? Do you see it as an opportunity to grow? Do you see it as an opportunity to learn? Do you see it as an opportunity for God to do what only God can do? Do you see it as an opportunity for God to do something in your life? Because the way that we view it, the way that we understand it, the way that we approach it can make all the difference in terms of the decision that we make. Because if we see it as something that can consume us, that can overwhelm us, we're going to want to pull back. We're going to want to run away. Because that feels scary and it feels dangerous. But if we see it as an opportunity for refinement, and we see it as an opportunity to grow, if we see it as an opportunity for God to do something in our life, it can produce courage. It can produce confidence. It can produce faith. It can cause us to maybe to do something that might be against our base instincts. It can cause us to do something that might not feel normal or natural, but it might be the absolute best thing for us to do. So jump to verse 13 if you have your Bibles open. It says this: furious with rage, this is right after they've been told Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego won't bow, Nebuchadnezzar summoned Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So these men were brought before the king, and Nebuchadnezzar said to them, "Is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the image of gold that I have set up? Now, when you hear the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, pipe, and all kinds of music, if you're ready to fall down and worship the image I made, very good. But if you do not worship it, you will be thrown immediately into a blazing furnace. Then what God will be able to rescue you from my hand?" So, Nebuchadnezzar lays it out. All right, last chance, guys. Fall in line, or this is going to happen immediately. And then what are you going to do? What are you going to do? Who could possibly deliver you from my hand? Because the Babylonians saw the king as a god. They saw him as a god-like figure. So in Nebuchadnezzar's mind, I am all-powerful. Nobody is going to push back against me. Nobody is going to challenge me. Nobody is not going to follow along without being punished severely. So he lays out the decision for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Verse 16, they respond. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to him, King Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to deliver us from it, and he will deliver us from your majesty's hand. But even if he does not, we want you to know, your majesty, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold that you have set up. So we have their decision. They say, we're not going to bow. We're not going to bow down to your God, because we believe and we serve in a God who is able and will deliver us. But even if he does not, we will not bow down. We will not worship the statue that you have set up. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego aren't concerned so much with the outcome. They're concerned with making the most faithful, obedient decision that they can make, regardless of the outcome. Do they believe that God can and will deliver them? Yes, they do. But they also have, but even if God, in his sovereignty, chooses not to, we will still make the same decision. Think about that for a second. Think about the courage that it would take to say that to the king. King, we just want you to know, no matter what happens, whether this goes well for us and we live or if we die, we will not bow. We will not do what you've commanded us to do. We will not worship the statue. We will be obedient to God. We will only do what God has asked us to do. Because sometimes we need to make the right decision regardless of what the outcome might be. And so often we make a decision based on the outcome that we want or the outcome that we're working for or the outcome that seems most favorable to us. But there's times we just simply need to make the right decision, the best decision that we can make, and trust that God will do what God can do in the midst of that circumstance. And it comes back to how we view the furnace. If you view it as an incinerator, if you view it as something that will consume you, we're going to naturally look to best possible scenarios or best possible outcomes. But if you view it as a refinery, as something that can grow us, as something that can strengthen us, as something that can refine us, we place that in God's hands and trust that in the midst of whatever circumstance it might be, that as we seek to be faithful to God, that God will be faithful to us. God is called a consuming fire. There's images of refinement that happen all throughout Scripture. Because they knew, I think, that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego knew that God would be faithful. Because they'd experienced it before, right? Daniel 1. They remained obedient to God and chose to eat only vegetables. They chose to not eat the royal food. They chose to not go along with everybody else, which took courage. It took them standing up to the king. It took them standing up to the king's officials to remain obedient to God. And they saw that God showed up. That God blessed them, that he helped them be stronger and look more fit and healthy than anybody else who ate the king's food, who just simply went along with the crowd to be like everybody else. And when we're facing these kinds of decisions, that's part of what we think about, right? Like, how have we seen God show up? How have you seen God act and work in those times in your life? When you've been in those pressure-packed, heated moments, when you feel the weight of everything, how have you seen God show up? How have you seen God be faithful? How have you seen God grow you, shape you, change you, refine you to be more like who God has created you to be? That's the moment that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are facing. They make their decision that they're not going to bow. So now we jump ahead to the climax where says that King Nebuchadnezzar was furious with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and his attitude toward them changed. He ordered the furnace heated 7 times hotter than usual and commanded some of the strongest soldiers in his army to to tie up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and throw them into the blazing furnace. So I was kind of curious about what this furnace might be. So the most likely explanation is that it would have been a brick kiln. It would have been a big kiln that they would use to bake bricks, that they would use for building their cities, to build their homes. So I want you to picture kind of a dome-like structure with a chimney that would come up the top with an opening in the front. The opening in the front, they could put the fuel in, they could add more things to the fire. And if you read through in Daniel 3, you're going to see them adding things like pitch and other things in order to stoke this fire, to get it burning extra hot. And there would be a vent at the top to let smoke and everything else escape from the fire. And that is where they would look to drop Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in. But these kilns, in order to bake bricks, would be heated to around 1,700 degrees Fahrenheit. Think about that for a second. 1,700 degrees Fahrenheit in this fire. And Nebuchadnezzar, I want it seven times hotter than that. So just picture super hot, right? I'm not going to give you a number because we don't know the number. Really, really, really hot. Hotter than what they would have needed to make bricks. Hotter than what they have needed to do the things that they would typically do. In fact, it's so hot, if you read the story, that the soldiers who bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego up to the mouth of the furnace to drop them in are killed by the heat escaping out of this furnace. The heat is so powerful, the heat is so overwhelming, that it kills the soldiers who are simply carrying out their duty to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego into the mouth of this furnace. I want you just to picture that scene of what's going on as they see this begin to occur. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the story says, fell into the fire. They fall down in. And Nebuchadnezzar, as he's looking in from the front, he would have the opening in the front, they could look. Nebuchadnezzar is there watching to see how this is all going to play out. And what does he see? He sees another one in the fire, one like a son of the gods. He said, weren't there three men who were thrown in? I see four, and he looks like a son of the gods. Because God was faithful to be with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the midst of the fire. In the midst of this moment, in the midst of everything that they were facing, God showed up and was present with them. So, when we look at this story in the Greek Old Testament, a Greek translation of the Old Testament, there are some different portions that we see show up in different manuscripts over the time. It's in a portion of the Bible, it's called the Apocrypha, that we don't see in most of our Bibles, but you can find them, you can read them, and it's things that show up in a number of manuscripts over the years, but when the Bible was created at the Council of Nicaea, they weren't included in the canon. And one of them is a portion called the Prayer of Azariah. Azariah is Abednego. And I want you just to hear a few of these verses, because this is a prayer that's recorded that was prayed by Abednego and by Shadrach and Meshach in the midst of the fire. It says this, bless the Lord, Hananiah, Azariah, and Mishael. That was their Judean names. Sing praise to him and highly exalt him forever, for he has rescued us from Hades and saved us from the power of death and delivered us from the midst of the burning fiery furnace. From the midst of the fire, he has delivered us. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. All who worship the Lord, bless the God of gods. Sing praise to him and give thanks to him, for his mercy endures forever. Just leave that right there for just a minute. So in the midst of this, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego worship God. In the midst of the fire, in the midst of the flames, in the midst of everything they're facing, this is the song, this is the prayer, this is the expression of worship to God that comes out of their mouths in the midst of the fire. When we find ourselves in these moments, what is it that comes out of our mouth towards God? Is it complaint, frustration, anger, disappointment? Worship, praise, thanksgiving. I'm not suggesting that one is right and one is wrong, but what is it that comes out of your mouth when you face these moments? Because how we see God and how we view God working in the midst of these circumstances, I believe directly relates how we do that. Look at what Isaiah wrote, chapter 43. Chapter 43, verse 2. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. We see it in the prayer of Ezra, and we see it recorded here through the prophet Isaiah. It reminds us of who God is, what God does, and how God can be at work even in the midst of those furnace-like moments of life, when we feel the heat, when we feel the pressure, when we feel the weight. Do you trust God even in the midst of the fire? Will you praise God even in the midst of that? What would your song sound like? What would your prayer sound like? How have you seen this happen, where you saw God show up in unbelievable ways in the midst of big moments in your life? When you saw God be faithful to give you wisdom, when you saw God be faithful to provide, when you saw God be faithful just to bring comfort or strength or peace. I want to invite you to think about a few things with me this morning as we wrap up. Number one, what's a big life-changing decision you've made? Or maybe you need to make. Maybe you can't think of one that you've made already, but what's one that maybe you're worried about? What's one that's maybe on your heart? What's one that maybe is feeling like it's consuming you, is weighing you down, is kind of hanging over you? Then how can you shape and view that decision in light of who you know God to be? Secondly, do you view furnace moments as incinerator moments to be avoided, or refining moments that can grow us? Do you run from them? Do you avoid them? Do you try to eliminate them? Do you try to hope that they won't occur? Right? Because Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego could have avoided the whole thing. All they needed to do was bow. All they needed to do was just go along with it. Right? The king said it. Just do it now and we're good. It'll be fine. No harm done. But they chose to step into the furnace. They chose to step into that moment with faith. They chose to step into that decision and trust that God would be there with them, and that that could be a moment that God could use to refine and to grow them. And here's the last thing. How have you seen God be with you in difficult circumstances, and how can that shape how you'll see God with you in the future? Thomas said at the beginning of the service that, you know, life groups, small groups are so important, where we can be in relationship with other people. And I believe that one of the big strengths of them is to be able to share things like this. For us to be able to come together and to be able to share stories of who we have seen God be, how we've seen God show up. Because that can be such a source of encouragement and strength and support for anybody when they're facing those moments. That we can believe that if God has been there for them, God can be there for me. If God was here for me like this in the past, he will be here for me now and in the future. Maybe not in the way that I would hope, maybe not in the way that I would expect, but God will be faithful and God will show up. Because Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego knew that no matter what the circumstances would be, that God would hold them. God would care for them. Whether that was to protect them from the flames or to welcome them into eternity with him, they knew without a shadow of a doubt that no matter what happened, that it would be because God was going to be faithful to them and watch over them, to remind them of who he is. And when we face these moments, we can make that same decision of how we're going to make those decisions, how we're going to approach them, how we're going to think about them. And when we do that, we can experience God in amazing ways as we see his goodness and his faithfulness to us. Would you pray with me? God, I thank you, Lord, that you are faithful and that you're good. And God, that you work with us in God to so many ways and circumstances. God, that you step into those moments of our life. And God, you remind us that you're there. You remind us, God, that you love us. You remind us, God, that you care. Oh, Lord, I just want to pause for a moment. God, I just want to lift up anybody who's maybe in one of those moments. They're in a season in their life when they're just feeling just a lot of weight, a lot of pressure, a lot of uncertainty, a lot of worry, a lot of doubt. Lord, this morning, may you remind them, God, that you're faithful, that you're present, that you're loving, that you're gracious, that you're kind. May you remind them, God, the promise of Isaiah, God, that when they pass through the waters, God, you will be with them. When they pass through the fire, they will not be consumed. Lord, may that give us comfort. May it give us strength. May it give us hope. As we fix our eyes on you, Lord, as we seek to follow you with our lives. And I pray this in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. Would you please stand with me? Thank you.
darkness, you have filled me with peace.
Service. As a reminder, if you're looking for a place to connect, I invite you to stop in our Connection Center right through that door right there. We'd love to show you some place you can connect, to use your gifts to connect with others. But I want to invite you just to open your hands, to open your hearts, to open your minds, to receive this blessing from the Lord. May you know the love of God. May you know the grace that is offered to you through His Son, Jesus Christ. May you know the peace, the confidence, the comfort, the strength of His Holy Spirit. May that lead and guide you throughout all of your life. Amen. Amen.